Welcome to the presentation of a lecture from Gnostic Radio, a free public service from Telema Press. Gnostic Radio broadcasts free lectures from the Gnostic tradition of Samael Aun Weor. Each lecture explores another aspect of this timeless and sacred knowledge. Many of these lectures are supported by additional materials available on our website. Each Saturday, Gnostic Radio broadcasts live. The live lecture is accompanied by an anonymous chat session, allowing listeners to read additional explanations related to the lecture and providing an opportunity to ask questions of the speaker. All of the efforts of Telema Press, including this lecture, are made possible by the financial support of listeners like you. Help us to help humanity by making a donation. Telema Press is a non-profit corporation. Donations are tax deductible. For more information, visit our website at GnosticTeachings.org. Now, with heartfelt wishes for the end of suffering for all creatures, we begin the lecture. May all beings be happy.
Virgo, the zodiacal sign of the Virgin, a beautiful sign that has a very profound esotericism. When we study the Greek-Roman mythology, we discover that Mercury, that is the planet that rules, or that is in the house of Virgo, is a messenger of the gods. In Greek terms, Mercury is called Hermes. You know, this word Hermes is utilized in different ways. For instance, in order to imply that behind certain phrases or terminologies or words, there is something hermetic, something hidden, which is knowledge, wisdom. That's why Hermes Mercury was qualified as the one that brings the word of God, the messenger of the gods. And Pausanias, this great writer, states that Mercury in ancient times was represented sharing the same throne of Jupiter, which is a very significant and profound. We have to, of course, inquire, to dig, to delve into the waters in order to discover the mystery of Mercury, which if we inquire of the origin of the word Mercury, which is a Latin word, we discover the word Mar, which in French is Mer, M-E-R. Mar, la mare, and curios, or cura, curia, which is the nuncio, messenger. So, Mercurius or Mercuria is, of course, we will say, the nuncio of the sea. That's why you see Mercurius or Mercuria or Mercury in some graphics emerged from the very bottom of the sea. La mare, mar, mer. Because indeed, Mercury is associated with the liquid water, since in among the metals, it is a liquid metal that is called quicksilver. And indeed, in alchemy, it represents the raw matter of the great work that each one of us has to perform. Alchemists state, give me or bring me mercury and I will do anything that you require from me. And of course, Mercury is represented Kabbalistically in the Tree of Life. In the mysterious Sephirah Da'at, which means knowledge. Because really, Mercury is the one that brings the knowledge from above, from the God, we will say. The triangle of God, which is above the Tree of Life, the first triangle, Keter, Chokmah, Binah, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, astrologically, is always placed in the sun. That's why when we talk about the central of the solar system, the sun, the solar light, we always point the Trimurti, the three primary forces, or what we call the holy triamatsikamno, the law of three, the law that creates, the solar light. These three forces in one, the Trinity, is what is called the cosmic Christ. And if you utilize right now your imagination, you will see the sun there in the center of the solar system. And the first planet rotating around it is Mercury. That's why many astrologers in the past stated that Mercury and the sun are one. When you study astrology, Kabbalah, and alchemy, you understand that statement. Because indeed, that, Kabbalistically speaking, that is below the three primary forces, the first triangle of Kabbalah, the Tree of Life, is the outcome. That is the outcome of that Trinity. You know that Da'at is made by the junction, the union of two parts, which are related with Binah. Within Kabbalah, Binah means understanding, comprehension. And of course, this Binah, comprehension, is what in Christianity we call the Holy Spirit. This Holy Spirit in India is called Shiva. And of course, Shiva, the Holy Spirit, divides in two parts in that in Hinduism is called Shiva Shakti. Here is where we find the marvelous duality which Mercury represents. Because if you see in the other sign, Gemini, Mercury is also there. But Mercury in Gemini is acting just in the surface. We will say it as a masculine aspect. We will say that Mercury in Gemini likes to know a little bit of everything. But Mercury in Virgo, which is the sign that we are entering right now, is the one that delves, goes deep down into the matter. As you see, Virgo is ruling or is ruled by the element Earth. So you have to dig into the Earth. So Virgo likes to dig, to inquire, to investigate, while Gemini is only in the surface, floating, we will say, like the air above the face of the waters. This masculine, feminine aspect of Mercury is telling us that it's an androgynous aspect. Had two polarities. Of course, we are explaining here its feminine aspect, Virgo, the Virgin. A very important aspect that most of this present humanity ignore. Because about the Virgin, the feminine aspect of Mercury, is talked or stated in many religions, talking about many types of virgins. Without going so far or back in time, we just go into Christianity and we find the Virgin Mary, which if you inquire the word Mary, has also the word Mar, Mer, the sea. That's why Mary is celebrated in many parts of the world of Christianity as the Virgin of Carmel, Stella Maris, the star from the sea. Of course, we had to investigate and to inquire that really, when in esotericism we talk about the Virgin, about the mother, which in Latin is called mater. That's how you say it. The mater is precisely hidden within the wombs of Mercury, the mystery of hermetic philosophy. When you observe the planet Mercury, you find that it floats in the space and rotates around the sun. The sun, of course, sustains Jupiter by the electromagnetism, according to astronomy. But that space within which Mercury is floating is that sea that we are talking here, which in Hinduism receives the name of Akash. So that substance is also called Prakriti, the Divine Mother's space, which of course is not a person, but a substance. The primordial substance from which the worlds, suns, stars, the planets, and everything emerge from within it. That's why one of the aspects of Prakriti is the space. Scientists in this day and age talk about matter, but really they do not know anything about the matter itself, the substance itself, which in Kabbalah receives the name of Binah, intelligence, comprehension. Mercury is called the first begotten of creation. And it is because he's the first manifestation of the unknowable. This Mercury or Shiva, the Holy Spirit, is the one that brings the substances, the elements of the Divine Mother's space into activity. That's why you find that Mercury is represented as the Holy Spirit into masculine and feminine. So the Divine Mother's space, which is fecundated by Mercury, in its positive aspect, masculine aspect, is that substance that we call Prakriti, and that is represented in the mysterious Sephira Da'at, which is the union of the two polarities, within which the three primary forces dwell, in each one of them. That's why this primordial substance, Prakriti, the Akash, its name in ancient Egypt, at Isis, the mother space, Rea, Cibeles, Tonantzin, Maya. Of course, that substance, primordial intelligent substance, takes form in everything that exists. Any type of substance or element comes from it. All of those elements that are studied in science as compound or simple elements are nothing but the crystallization of that primordial substance. That's why we state that that primordial substance has eight aspects, or we will say crystallize in eight aspects. The fire, the water, the air, the earth, the space, mind, intellect, and ego. So these are the three crystallizations of that primordial matter. And going down into nature, we find that the Divine Mother, that primordial substance, is the origin of everything in nature, in any planet, as we stated. Because when we talk about nature, we always talk about the four elements, astrologically speaking. Because remember that astrologically, we stated that fire, earth, air, and water are related with the 12 zodiacal signs. Three zodiacal signs take the different elements. Like, for instance, the element earth, which is the second aspect now in Virgo, because the third is related with Capricorn. We talk about the first in the lecture of Taurus. So it is stated that in order for anything to come to exist, to come to be alive, to come to existence, it is because the disequilibrium of the elements, which are synthesized in the three gunas, which are called or named in Hinduism, or three aspects. The three gunas are named the guna sattva, the guna rayas, and the guna tamas. These three gunas are related, sattva, with knowledge, with wisdom. Rayas is related with desire. And tamas is related with inertia. Ignorance. When the primordial substance is in rest, then these three aspects, sattva, rayas, and tamas, are in equilibrium to go into this matter related with our psychology. In order to comprehend, we will state that sattva is related with the intellectual brain, rayas with the emotional brain, and tamas with the motor, instinctual, sexual brain. So we have here in the head sattva, wisdom, knowledge, intelligence, rayas in the emotional, in the solar plex, and tamas below, in those centers, we call motor, instinctual, sexual centers, which make that brain. So it is stated that in order to enter into the bosom of the unmanifested father, which receives many names, we call it the absolute. In order to enter into the bosom of the Father, these three gunas, or three aspects of matter, the Divine Mother, must be in equilibrium. If there is any disequilibrium, and then that is what is that originates creation. The disequilibrium of these three aspects or gunas of the Divine Mother is what creates any world, any planet, any entity in the universe. And is the outcome of karma. So karma is an effect of the disequilibrium of these three aspects at any level. That's why it is stated that when everything enters into equilibrium, after the karma is paid, everything returns into the bosom of the Divine Mother. But it doesn't go further. The bosom of the Father only receives all the elements which are in perfect equilibrium. Because the Divine Mother has those aspects in equilibrium just for a certain period, we will say, of time. But when those aspects enter again into disequilibrium, then the universe appears from that primordial substance, Prakriti. That's why it is stated that the Ein Sof is the origin of the cosmic days. Everything emerges from it, and everything returns to it. What we call Pralaya, cosmic night, or Maha Pralaya, great cosmic night, happens always within the womb of that primordial substance, which is the space, Prakriti. We call it the unmanifested mother. That substance is virgin. And this is what we have to understand and comprehend. The virgin substance of matter. When we investigate that primordial substance, we also discovered that it exists within every single human being. That's why in Christianity, they talk about the three Marys. The Mary in the space, we're talking here, the Prakriti space. The Mary or Mother in nature. Because also we talked several times about the Divine Mother Nature, which is the origin of all of these kingdoms in Malkut. Mineral, plant, animal, and human kingdoms. But also we have to comprehend and understand that the Divine Mother has also His individuality, her individuality within each one of us. In other words, that is precisely what in the Old Testament in Christianity, they talk about the four commandments. Honor your father and your mother. Many Christians, Jews, and many other scholars or religious people that do not have any right information, they assume that it is related with the physical mother and father that we have. That, of course, we have to respect. But that commandment is not related to our father and mother in the physical plane. It is directly related to that primordial substance, those elements that abide. In order to understand this, it is coming into my mind that part of the Gospels, the New Testament, when Paul, the apostle, says, don't you know that the Holy Spirit dwells in your body and that your physical body is the temple of the Holy Ghost? So we're talking here about this. But we have to understand that this Holy Ghost, this Holy Spirit, this Mercury is an energy, it's a force. Or as we say, a spirit. This Mercury exists and abides in all of our body. The two aspects, masculine and feminine. And of course, the two polarities of the Holy Spirit, of this Mercury, of the sacred philosophy, alchemy, is that father and mother, which are hidden in the mysterious that knowledge, later with Hermes, Mercury. That substance that can originate a transformation in us. Here, in the physical body, we see, for instance, as we said in the beginning, that Mercury and Jupiter were sharing, according to ancient sages, the same throne. Then we had to inquire in the physical body. That Mercury emerges from the sea. And we see that in Gemini, it's related with the air, which is the spirit, the force. That in the last synthesis is situated in the brain. Because remember that Mercury is also related with the intellect, with the mind. And that's why Virgo and Gemini are characterized because of the ability to use the mind. And of course, Mercury, or the Prakriti, as we stated, is the origin of the mind and the intellect, and the ego. And the vehicle of the mind is the brain. Anyone can verify this. When we use our mind, we use our brain. But we have to know the relationship of the brain with the different glands. In this case, for instance, the pituitary and pineal gland related with the brain and with the sexual glands or with the womb. We are not going to go so deep into the sexual gland because that is a lecture related with Scorpio. But let me tell you that ancient sages stated that Virgo and Scorpio were one single sign, or were sharing one sign. If we don't know anything about alchemy and Kabbalah, we will say, how? How is this possible? Well, Virgo, the virgin, rules stomach, the womb, the woman. And obviously the uterus is a sexual organ. On each side you find the ovaries of the woman. And of course, in order for that womb to be fecundated, the man needs to put its own Mercury, the male aspect we are talking here, which is the sperm, into the womb. But the fetus, or the fetus in this case, I always said fetus, but it's fetus, develops within the womb, which is Virgo. But here we have to comprehend that there are two aspects that we need to comprehend in relation with the Virgin, with that substance, which is the origin of this physical body that we have. Because we know that the embryo, we call it the human embryo, which is developed within the womb of physical mother, is developing and growing thanks to the activities of the divine mother, of that primordial substance that multiplies, which in the beginning is very, how you call, gelatinous, very soft, and you form the first cell, germinal cell, within the womb of the mother. Little by little, that cell is accumulating the different earth elements, calcareous, we will say, elements that that embryo needs in order to build a skeleton. And little by little, while the divine mother of that substance is crystallizing and making the skeleton of that embryo, finally the fetus appears within the womb of our physical mother. But remember that the physical mother is only a vehicle, a vessel, within which this intelligence works. Unfortunately, and this is precisely a big point here, we were engendered through fornication. Because if we knew about this aspect, and that the Divine Mother and that the Holy Spirit abides within fecundation, because it's life, because God is life, we will be fecundated in other ways. But we were fecundated as animals through fornication. We didn't take care of the seed. In other words, from our main origin, physical origin, we are emerging from the broken law. We are broken the law, breaking the law, which is fornication. And this is very important here to state, because it is stated, or people have the idea, that fornication that the Bible talks about abundantly is a sexual act before being married. They think that God is very concerned with certain papers or signatures of this physical world. They don't understand that God is life, and He doesn't care a bit about any signature or title there that we'll put on the wall about that we are certified married. For this society in which we live, it's necessary, if you wish. But under the eyes of God, to marry is to unite two forces. And fornication is when those forces are utilized in the wrong way. That is squandered, we would say. That's why we stated in the glossary in the website that fornication is related with the word furnace, the oven, which in ancient times was used in order to burn or to gather the seed, the grain of the garden. And of course, the Garden of Eden, where we have the seed, which is a sexual force, when we burn that energy, that force in the sexual act, that's the furnace. When we fornicate, when we utilize the fire in the wrong way, the fire of the Divine Mother and our Divine Father. When we do that, we don't honor our father and mother. So all of us, this whole humanity, is the outcome of fornication. Animals in the kingdom, irrational animals, because they are irrational, they are not blamed for fornication. But we receive the commandments, the rules, in order for us to take advantage of the sexual energy. To honor father and mother means to know how to utilize our own particular Mercury. In order to know how to build in our own particular womb, our own humanity. But behold, in spite of that, we made the Holy Spirit, the Divine Mother, to work through fornication. That was written, whosoever fornicates sins against the Holy Ghost. Of course, we all sin against the Holy Ghost, or that Mercury, that force. And we are born in a situation that we call karma. The Holy Spirit starts building a body of death, a body that eventually will die. The physical body is situated or is condemned to death. It's written. Anybody that eats from that fruit will surely die. And this is nothing new, that all of us which are here, sooner or later, will die. But the creator, of course, of this body is the Holy Spirit, creator of life. Not, of course, through immaculate conception, but through sin. Because immaculate means without a spot, without sin, without blemish. But for all of us, we're not. We know that our father and mother were fornicating, lustfully delivering themselves to lust, to the animal lust. This is why we are here, all of us. And that's why the body that the Divine Mother created for us in the womb of our physical mother is a body of sin, the outcome of fornication, within which is placed that karma, karma of fornication. That's why it is stated that all of us are born with that sin. With that sin. I repeat, because I hear myself and it sounds like without. But it's not without, it's with that sin of fornication. And the body which is being formed within the womb of our physical mother is made according to our own karma. To begin with the genotype, which is the karma of fornication. Because our father and physical mother gave us that genotype, that inheritance in the very moment of their fornication, in the sexual act. And our soul was connected to that sperm because of karma in order to be developed. So all the substances, elements, that the Divine Mother needs in order to create that body, of course, is taken through the physical body of our physical mother. Because the father, the only thing that does, is to place the seed. This is the duty of the man, to place the seed into the womb. But the one that takes the whole work to make that body is the Divine Mother. The feminine aspect. You see? So in this case, you see that the Divine Mother suffers because her children do not respect her. And that's why it is stated that when one prostitutes his own or her own body, that matter, which is the physical body, turns into a whore. And that's why in India, for instance, Kali is worshipped in two ways. Kali, the Divine Mother that everybody respects, and Kali, the negative aspect, which is a whore. In other words, we don't respect, we don't honor our Divine Mother. We don't honor father and mother because we ignore about this aspect that we are talking here. So the body is created, you know, during 9 months. And little by little, the Divine Mother is crystallizing in substances, elements, in order to create the different organs according to the law of karma. And that's why she suffers. Because in certain times, she's creating something that she shouldn't. But the law has to be obeyed. And we live in this valley of tears. And one is born in the family and different substances according to that law of karma, which will be explained in the next lecture. So you see here how that primordial substance, which is called Akash, which in different lectures in the past, we explained in the lectures of transformation of energy, how that Akash is related with our sexual matter. The Akash is called the semen, or the raw matter, or the great work. It's called the raw mercury, or the brute mercury. So that brute mercury, the semen, whether in the woman or in the man, because the semen in the woman is feminine. But that energy is that the one that takes all the substances to the body of the woman, which is really a great laboratory in which that baby is growing and developed. But I repeat again, we are being developed and created within the womb of our physical mother. But the one that is making that body is the Divine Mother. She's the one that makes it. Every time in any womb, according to the 108 lives that we have to have. Or any vehicle. She's always the one that works. Whether in the mineral kingdom, in the plant kingdom, in the animal kingdom, or in the human kingdom. So, the baby, the fetus that is being developed within the womb of Virgo, when it comes out, it's a marvelous body created by the Divine Mother, which is full of life. But you observe the body of a newborn coming from the womb of the Divine Mother, you will understand that all the elements that the woman took in order to build it was sexual matter, sexual forces. Because the womb itself is her sexual organ. And that's why this is precisely the statement that we were talking in the beginning, that ancient sages stated that Virgo and Scorpio were one sign. Were one in ancient times when people respected the fire, the forces of the Holy Spirit. But they separated. And now, of course, the body that we inherit, the physical body, grows up according to karma, according to the law. And we see that In the beginning, the three parts of that physical body, of that newborn baby, is very subtle, gelatinous. And one part is calcareous, strong. And that's why the flexibility the body of a newborn has. But when we investigate any adult, we discover that his body is no longer 3% gelatinous and 1% calcareous. Now it is 3% calcareous and 1% gelatinous. And little by little, it's turning into a hard rock. That's why in the beginning we see that the newborn baby takes any food. And when you investigate the urine or the excrement of these newborn babies, you don't find any substance, hard substances like, for instance, what you find in the adults, like calcium and many other those concrete matters that are abundant in the adult body. You don't find those elements in the urine of any baby or any child, because what he eats is utilized in order to strengthen the internal organs and the skeleton. While when we are already adult, the physical body no longer needs that. And we still take those elements into our body, and the body is accumulating or putting them in different parts of the body, causing, of course, diseases, sicknesses. It is very normal in this day and age to find people with stones in the kidneys, or in the gallbladder, or in different substances, different organs, I mean. You see, for instance, that liquid called synovia, which helps the joints, especially in the knees, in order to have flexibleness or in the joints of your body, is turning into a hard substance with the time. And that's why people start walking slowly and having different type of problems in their organism. And it is because the ignorance of what we eat. That's why when we talk about Virgo, we have to understand and comprehend the mystery of the Virgin. But since the beginning we are breaking the law, we continue doing it through our life, and we ignore that what to eat, or in which way to feed our bodies. It is not the same to feed our body when we are a child, or when we are young, or an adult, that we already pass the adulthood. We are going to the elderlyhood. We have to know what to eat, what to drink. Because most of the time, we eat food that brings those concrete elements that we no longer need. A boy, a girl, a young body needs those elements. And that's the way they eat anything, because they are growing. They want to have strong muscles and tendons and skeleton. But when we are already adults, we have to know how to feed ourselves and to see which type of food that we put into our stomach is good and what other type of food is bad for us. Because our organism, every one of us has a different type of organism. So we have to inquire to see, according to our sign as well. Because according to the sign of Virgo, we have three types of food: sattvic, rajas, and tamasic. The sattvic is in relation, of course, with fruits, vegetables, any type of grain that contain the pure energy of the sun. That Mother Nature places in all of its, elements, or all of her productions, creations, in the mineral, or in this way, we would say, in the plant kingdom. Remember that the trees, vegetables, in the plant kingdom are made by Mother Nature. And just to the sight, to be desirable, to eat, and then to feed our organism. Those elements, sattvic elements, like vegetables and fruits, have a lot of energy, substances that we need. And that do not create too much calcareous elements, hard elements that will cause sicknesses and problems into our physical body. Unfortunately, when those elements are adulterated, we only eat the matter, but the substance itself, the solar force, is no longer there. That's why we always insist on eating organic food, something that is not adulterated, crafted. Because as students of esotericism, we know that everything goes into Virgo, our stomach. In the intelligence of our Divine Mother in the stomach, it works exactly in the pancreas. Digest that. Transform that into substances that we need in order to be alive and in order to work in this work that we need to perform. Remember that the womb is, of course, the organ, the sexual organ, where the Divine Mother develops this physical body. But it is stated that we receive this physical body in order to be born again. Everybody knows that we have to be born again. But nobody can be born again without the activity of the Holy Spirit, without the activity of Mercury, without the activity of the waters. That's why in India, Mercury, or Mercurius, the third logos, is Shiva and Shakti. But in esotericism, the spinal column, or better said, the spinal medulla, is another womb. We have two wombs. When I say this, it's coming into my mind, Nicodemus and Jesus. When he asked about the second birth, how an old man can be born again, he asked. Can he enter into the womb of his mother and born again? He's talking about the physical mother. But to enter into another womb and to be born again. And then the Master Jesus wonders because Nicodemus, who was a great Kabbalist at that time, he didn't know about the second womb. We have another womb, whether we are man or woman. And that womb is the spinal medulla. And the spinal medulla is that spiritual womb where the second birth is effectuated, is done by the Holy Spirit. The Divine Mother is the one that has to enter there, has to be fecundated. Here you have to understand that one thing is to be created physically in the womb of a physical mother, which is a creation of the Divine Mother, but through fornication. And another thing is the second birth, the spiritual birth, that many Christians think that is a matter of believing in something. But no one can be born again by believing in this physical world, which is the lowest. We need in order to be born, in order to be alive physically, we need the sexual act of two, father and mother. Why we think? So why we conceive that in order to be born again is just by believing? It's impossible. The Divine Mother, the Holy Spirit, it is written in the Bible, is the one that originates the second birth. And that's why it's always represented with the baptism. That anybody that wants to be born again, symbolically, has to be baptized. That baptism is a submerging into the waters. But not physical waters, that's a symbol in any religion. For that, we need to know that the Divine Mother had to be fecundated spiritually in that other womb, which is the spinal medulla. That's why in esotericism, in Hinduism, the spinal medulla is related with the seven chakras, the seven churches, according to the book of Revelation. And there is where the Divine Mother creates these other vehicles, which are immortal, which are not subject to death. Our physical body is subject to death. And that creation is in another dimension, because it's a spiritual birth, electronic, we would say. In order to be there and to be born again, it is necessary to be born by the Spirit, which is the Holy Spirit, and by the water. We know, we have to know how to transmute the sexual waters in the sexual act, and not to fornicate. Because the one that fornicates cannot be born again. I mean, the one that spills, the one that reaches the orgasm, the spasm in the sexual act, never can be born again. There are many couples in Christianity that they respect their matrimony, they don't commit adultery, but they fornicate during the sexual act. They reach the orgasm. It is necessary to make a clarification in all the dictionaries, because they always mix fornication with adultery. They say the same thing. So when one transmutes the sexual energy, when one do not commit the sacrilege of fornication, then the Divine Mother creates an immortal body. She's fecundated by the Holy Spirit. That fecundation happens within your own matter. Because your own physical body is that matter. It's Malkut in Kabbalah. The physical body is Malkut. And in Kabbalah, Malkut is control, or is, it says it is feminine. Feminine body. Because it's the creation of the Divine Mother. From that matter is how we originate the Immaculate Conception. So the Immaculate Conception, which is written in the Gospels, is not physical conception. We don't deny that it could be a type of birth in which the woman can be pregnant, can become pregnant, without the orgasm. That's a type of birth that the Bible talks as well. Physical bodies that have been born without the orgasm. Because a single sperm can live easily from the sexual glands of a man when connected with a woman. And the woman can be pregnant easily without spilling millions of seeds, without fornication, in other words. And there are many masters, many individuals that were born like that, which are not the outcome of the orgasm. But that is not the birth that we are talking here. The birth that is originated by Mary is related with our own particular individual Mary. Because you have to understand that Mary in Christianity is talk in three aspects, as I said in the beginning. Mary in the space, Mary in nature, and Mary in the human being. So each one of us has his own particular Mary. That particular Mary, that intelligence, created this physical body that we have now within the womb of our mother. Because we were created in this physical world through fornication. But when the Bible talks about the second birth, it is related with the second womb, not with the first womb. And that second womb is the spinal medulla. But for that, the Divine Mother also needs to be fecundated by the Holy Spirit. And that is only possible in the sexual act. And that's why Master Jesus of Nazareth performed his first miracle in the weddings of Cana. He transmuted the water of sexuality into the wine of the Spirit. This is a symbol that we have to comprehend. That birth is precisely happening when a couple in the holy matrimony do not commit the mistake of reaching the orgasm. When they learn how to transmute means to transform the matter into energy. You see, the matter into energy. The matter is the mother. The primordial substance, which is the Akash in the sexual organs. When that Akash, that matter, is transformed into energy, that energy eventually is transformed into another subtle matter, which is immortal. That's the second birth. And is originated in the spinal medulla, with the famous Kundalini in the seven chakras. Had to rise. The Divine Mother is the one that performs that in the spinal medulla. So when that happens, she's virgin. He is originating from his primordial substance something holy, something new, that is not the outcome of orgasm like any animal in this physical world. That second birth, it doesn't appear here in this three-dimensional world, because this three-dimensional world is the outcome of fornication. It's the fallen Sephira, Malkut. The second birth is originated up in the tree of life, And of course, a tree of life, as you know, is a spinal column. It's a spinal medulla. That's the tree of life. And in there is how those bodies, celestial bodies, spiritual bodies, are being created when we know how to transmute the substance of that virgin, our own particular individual Virgin Mary, Mare, which is that Akash, the substance, that Mar, that sea that we have in the sexual organs. And then she needs to be fecundated by the Holy Spirit. Who is this Holy Spirit? It's the same Mercury that is represented, of course, in the brain. When you study endocrinology, you find the relationship of the brain and the glands, the pituitary and pineal gland, in relation with the sexual glands. You need willpower. We need the activity of the Holy Spirit in the pineal gland in order to fecundate our own particular matter, our own particular virgin. And this is how the master emerges. When it is stated that the Virgin Mary was fecundated by the Holy Spirit, see the activity of Mercury there, inside the body of any initiate. The announcement of that is Gabriel. And Gabriel represents the moon, the positive aspect of the moon that works through the waters. That's why it is stated that Gabriel also appears to Mohammed. In this case, is more understandable in Islamic religion, because Gabriel appears to Mohammed and tells him what to do. The same happened with Jesus, but it's written symbolically. Because in order for Gabriel to act, he needs to fecundate, or to say, hey, the Holy Spirit is going to fecundate your divine mother. That's the substance. It is wonderful when you meditate and you discover that virgin within you, because she exists. When she is not fecundated by the Holy Spirit, she appears dark, without light of the Holy Spirit. So this is how the Virgin Mary is inside of us, dark. But when she becomes fecundated by the fire of the Holy Spirit, which is through chastity, when we respect the sexual act, then she becomes illuminated with a lot of light. And little by little, the baby Jesus is growing in her womb. But that womb is the spinal column. You have to understand that she's matter. She has no form. But she enters in your organism in order to save you. And as fire, she rises in the spinal column. And is creating little by little, step by step, the baby Jesus, the Savior. Which is another body. That Savior is another body that we have to create within. Within that womb. And this is how the Divine Mother is fecundated in us. And that's why it is stated that Buddha was fecundated by the Holy Spirit. In this case, in Buddhism, the white elephant represents the positive forces of the Holy Spirit. As in Christianity, the white dove is the one that represents the masculine aspect of the Holy Spirit. And of course, the Virgin Maya, I believe, is the one that is or is fecundated by this white elephant. And then Buddha is being born. People that read that, read literally. And he thinks that the mother of Buddha was a physical mother, and an elephant in dreams appear and said he was pregnant, physically pregnant. But it's not that. It means that the physical body of Buddha, through Tantra, was fecundated the womb of the Divine Mother, which is the spinal medulla. And this is how he became illuminated. Because Buddha means an illuminated one. If you see, Krishna was born also from an immaculate conception. People that think that Jesus is the only one that was born by immaculate conception are mistaken. All masters of all religions were born by immaculate conception. Because the master comes inside. The master is not the physical body. The physical body is just a frame that we have in this three-dimensional world that we have to utilize in order to be born again. And in order to do it, we have to know how to fecundate our Divine Mother. Because if our Divine Mother created this physical body in the womb of my physical mother, she has the power also to create an immortal body. And she does it in my spinal column. And this is how the master appears, the prophet, the Buddha, which is inside. He is then garbed with the wedding garment of the soul, because he knows how to transmute the water into wine. It's not that the people think that the first miracle that Mr. Jesus made was because there were a lot of drunks in that party and they needed more wine in order to get drunk. So Jesus made a lot of wine in order to keep drinking. You know, to read that in a very literal way is some funny. It's very funny and ludicrous. Master Jesus don't want to cooperate with vice. That is an alchemical symbol that we have to understand. And he is doing that in the weddings of Cana, because in the matrimony is how we have to do it. That's why it's originated. All the great masters were Mary. And that's why when they take Mary Magdalene out of life of Jesus, he says, well, then Jesus is not a master. Because no one can originate that without the feminine aspect. If you as a man was to create internally within you your individual particular Jesus Christ, which is called the astral body, and very well explained that in the seven words in the website, that book, you need as a man a woman. Because the substance, the primordial substance of the woman have the elements, which are related with the ovum. And your masculine body has the masculine substances, which are related with the testicles. In this physical world, you cannot create a single physical body only with the sperm, with the soul sperm. You need the ovum. Ovum and sperm, or soul sperm, which makes life in the physical world. The same thing in the spiritual world. You need the primordial substances, elements of the woman to mix it with yours. That is what is called the soul of the Mercury, in order to create within you your inner Jesus Christ in your own womb. And then you become another one who are that is being born through immaculate conception, and you are the son of Virgin Mary. Or if you want to call that Virgin Isis, Isoberta, Rhea, Cibeles, Tonantzin, Maya, Maia, doesn't matter. Because the Virgin Mother of the world and the universe is represented in many aspects. So here we have to understand that the second birth, the spiritual birth, is not related with the sexual organ of the woman that should be virgin. that the hymen should be there in order to be virgin. When the Gospels state that Mary was virgin, state her own state, her own level. Because as well, we are going to talk now about the Virgin Mary, that great being that was a vehicle in order for Jesus to have his physical body. She was also virgin. And now we are talking about this great being that came 2,000 years ago. She was virgin. But this virginity that we are talking here right now has nothing to do with the hymen. Hymen, right? With the hymen. With that organ or tissue that makes to say this woman is virgin or not. No, it's not related with that. It's related with the state of the consciousness. In the man, when the man reaches the fifth initiation of major mysteries, he's called a master, a prophet. But a woman in the internal worlds that reaches the level of the fifth initiation of major mysteries is called a virgin. When you enter into nirvana, you find many virgins, meaning many women that are born again. Feminine vehicles in the physical plane, like Fuji. Oh no, I'm sorry, it's Quan Jin, isn't it? Quan Shi Jin. That is worship in Taoism. Among the Chinese, you find that great initiate, Quan Shi Jin, who is a master, but is feminine. So in other words, esoterically speaking, hermetically speaking, we say she's a virgin. She's an initiate. She is a woman that knows everything about esotericism. In ancient times, those virgins were in the temples of ancient civilizations. Celibate men that wanted to self-realize themselves were getting married in those temples with any of those virgins that they were called vestals, that never fornicated, because the one that fornicates is not a virgin. Is a whore. Any woman that reaches the spasm or the orgasm is not a virgin. You find many women in this day and age that never had the sexual act, but they masturbate. They're not virgins, even if they have the hymen there. That virgin state is a state of the consciousness, of the spirit. And this is how the Virgin Mary was a vestal of the Temple of Jerusalem. And she was chosen by the White Lodge in order to give to Master Jesus the physical body. It was everything planned in accordance to, in order to teach the wisdom to humanity. So physically, we Gnostics, we don't care about the hymen. Even though you can have a lot of powers if the woman keep the hymen. There's a lot of other type of wisdom, but we are not going to talk about that right now. But for us, a virgin is a woman that is in chastity and that knows how to transmute, a tantric woman, a master. And of course, with them, the initiate would marry and creating their internal bodies, being born again. In this case, Mary Magdalene, Magdala, Mag, magician, priestess of ancient times, of the white race, was married with Jesus. It is stated that she was a prostitute. Yeah, any virgin before becoming virgin was a prostitute, meaning was a fornicator. Anyone before entering into this path, his mother is prostituted. Before entering into this path, we were fornicating. We were committing adultery. But when we started transmuting, then we were transforming our matter into virgin, chaste matter. It's the same the woman. Those women of ancient times, before becoming great masters, great virgins, they were whores, they were prostitutes. But they transformed themselves and became great abbots, initiates. That's why it's stated that Mary Magdalene was a prostitute. But not only her. All women before entering into the abbothood were like that. They transformed themselves and they became holy. That's the way we should understand and comprehend virginity and prostitution. So there you find that Mary Magdalene helped Jesus to be born again. And Jesus helped Mary Magdalene to be born again too. And Christ was in Jesus as in Mary Magdalene. Because Christ is an energy. It's a force, like the electricity. Electricity is a force. It's not an individual. Christ is diluted in the space. It's in the center of any sun. And Christ needs to be born within every human being. And does it through his own matter. Because it needs to crystallize within that Akash in order to evolve within each one of us. And this is what is Jesus Christ, the Savior. The Savior has to be born inside by sexual transmutation. The woman has to be a virgin. But as you see, the symbol is clear. Before becoming saint, one is a devil. Remember Paul of Tarsus. He was being born again, but before entering into the path, he was killing Christians. So, not only him. If we investigate our past lives, we were barbarians. So there are many types of initiates. Before entering into the path, one is, of course, living the life of an animal and breaking the law. And this is how we understand how the virgins were being born. This is how we have to understand what the sign of Virgo teaches. The sign of the virgin. All of us have that substances in the physical body. All of us have that virgin in our soul, in our consciousness. But we have to honor father and mother. And we have to know how. It's not by believing. The one that is being born again has a vehicle with which, when the physical body is sleeping, enters into the internal world with his own particular Jesus Christ, with this person created. But right now, your divine mother has to suffer the pains of delivering until Jesus Christ is being born within us. Not by believing, not by accepting or entering into any sect. It's by doing the work, by understanding that Mercury is precisely that element that is the messenger of the gods. As right now, for instance, see astrology how it works. I am talking now and using my mind, my Mercury. But this Mercury here is the outcome of the transmutation of the forces that I perform in my individual life. And that's why it says that Mercury always brings and bringing the word to other people, you know, to announce the decrees and laws of the gods, the superior parts of the being. You are there seated and receiving the doctrine that through Mercury, through Hermes, through the giver of the word, is given unto you. But in Virgo, you find that in order to understand and comprehend the word, you need to work with your womb, which is the telepathic center. That's why with your mind, with your pineal gland, where is the third logos, Mercury, you send the thought. you send the meaning of the word. And in order to comprehend, you need to digest that in your telepathic center, which is in the solar plex between the heart and the navel. That's a telepathic chakra. You see, you receive here the thoughts of people. And it's there precisely in the stomach, in this area, because we have to digest the wisdom. Virgo works here. It's ruling the stomach, the intestines, pancreas, and all those elements necessary for digestion. Because it's the Divine Mother, the intelligence of the Divine Mother, that helps us to digest what we need to digest. If you see the intestines and you associate that with the roots of trees, you will understand why the physical body needs those roots, those intestines, in order to feed. Because the blood, of course, feeds all of our organism. But the blood takes its substances, all the elements, what we eat, what we drink, and what we place there in the stomach. So we have to be careful about what we eat, what we drink, in order to place in the blood the substances that we need in order to be born again. Because the Divine Mother is the one that does the whole work. This is how we study in the book of the Master Samael Aun Weor. The Divine Mother is the one that creates the bodies, that disintegrates the ego, because she is the intelligence. And for that, we need to go deep. We need to delve. We need to be like Virgo, very profound, analytically speaking. The sign of Virgo is very profound, very analytic, doesn't go in the surface. It likes to delve, to go down, and to squander there in the very bottom of the sea to see what's going on. Same thing. Meditation is a technique. And in meditation, we have to pray to our Divine Mother, because she's the one that deals with our physical organism. She takes the substances that we need in order from those roots, intestines, to go up and to feed our brain, our heart, to the blood. Because you know that the blood is the liquid element that brings all those substances to the body. But the Divine Mother is the one that takes those substances from our intestines, from the roots. And for that, he digests them in the stomach. She's the one that is doing. But why we have to blame our Divine Mother if we drink Coca-Cola? She would say, my son is putting some substances, stupid substances, that will poison the body. What can I do? She doesn't listen to me. She doesn't honor me. But if we study Mother Nature and Mother Space in our own particular Divine Mother, these three Marys in relation with our development, then we understand how to feed our bodies, because she needs those elements. When in meditation you have a contact with your Divine Mother, you experience your Divine Mother, she tells you what to eat. Why? Because she is the one that digests that, and she knows what we are eating. I need these elements, my son. Okay, Mother, where can I find these elements? Eat this from nature and that. And then the next day you awake and you go and buy those things, or take it from the forest, wherever you eat them, and then your Divine Mother takes the substances that she needs in order to keep giving you that second birth that you are wishing for. But unfortunately, in this day and age, scientists are adulterating all the elements that Mother Nature creates. That's precisely something very stupid. Thus, now we have to be very careful to eat what is natural. We need fire, rajasic elements. We need tamasic and sattvic. You see, the rajasic are related with salty food or very sweet, while tamas is in relation with meat. This is the lower. The Divine Mother needs also rayas, the tatuatejas, in order to transmute that fire and to give us these elements in a second birth. When we don't know the sacred law of trogo auto ego krat, the law of to eat and to be eaten, to swallow and to be swallowed, we know that we have to be balanced, but we need to eat meat. We should do what the Buddhists do in Tibet. They wait for the animal to have an accident and die in order to take the meat and eat. Or to wait for a lion to kill a deer and to steal the deer from the lion and to eat meat. But we need meat. If you are so identified with the brutality in which this day and age people kill the animals, we understand. They use brutality in order to kill animals. But what can we do? We need the meat. And not by avoiding eating meat, we are going to avoid this brutal killing that they are doing. But if we want to select the best, we can do it. But we need it. The Divine Mother needs those elements, because she works with the three aspects, sattva, rajas, and tamas, related with the three brains. If we get identified with beliefs, with theories, we don't understand the mysteries of the Hermetic doctrine. If we identify with desires, we identify with the guna rayas. And when you fall into inertia and laziness, we never work with tamas. Remember that in order to enter into the civilization, we need to balance the three brains, sattva, rayas, and tamas. These are the three brains. The Divine Mother needs to be equilibrated. And the Divine Mother is everywhere. The Divine Mother is not only in grains and fruits and vegetables. No, the Divine Mother is also in the body of any animal and the body of any mineral. We need to feed from her and to transmute her and to become and to transform her into a virgin. Little by little, we have to enter. That's why in the beginning, Paul of Tarsus says, you have to deal with your animal. First is the animal and then the spiritual. When you start, you need animal elements because you need fire. When you reach the second birth, then you can do whatever you want because you already have your inner bodies built. But before that, we need all the elements. Fish, meat. We know how to feed ourselves. And to acquire balance in the three brains. Right thought, upright feeling, and upright action. The ones that act like that have a balance in the three gunas. And they can enter into the kingdom of heaven. But if we start working in this psychological esoteric work and we reject certain elements that we need in the beginning, how are we going to acquire that balance? The Divine Mother needs to be balanced. And that's why we are here in this valley of tears and pain and suffering. Because our own particular mother is unbalanced. The three gunas are not equilibrated. So we need to work with the Divine Mother and equilibrate the three gunas. And to understand that she is in the four elements, is in the space, is in the mind, in the intellect, and in the ego. Because the ego is also a crystallization of the Divine Mother in her own way. That's why she is the one that has to annihilate that ego, to destroy it. Let me read for you a plegary written by this great initiate, Dante Alighieri, in his Divine Comedy. Virgin Mother, daughter of your Son, more humble and sublime than any creature, fixed goal decreed from all eternity, you are the one whom gave to human nature so much nobility that its creator did not disdain his being made its creature. That love whose warmth allowed this flower to bloom within the everlasting peace was love rekindled in your womb. For as above, you are the noonday torch of clarity, and there below on earth, among the mortals, you are a living spring of hope. Lady, you are so high, you can intercede that he who will have grace but does not seek your aid may long to fly but has no wings. Your loving kindness does not only answer the one who asks, but it is often ready to answer freely, long before the asking. In your compassion is, in you is pity, in you is generosity, in you is every goodness found in any creature. This man, who from the deepest hollow in the universe, up to this height, has seen the lives of spirits one by one, now pleased with you, through grace, to grant him so much virtue that he may lift his vision higher still, may lift it towards the ultimate salvation, and I, who never burned for my own vision, more than I burned from this, from his, do offer you all my prayers, and pray that they may not fall short, that with your prayers you may disperse all of the clouds of his mortality, so that the highest joy be his to see. This too, O Queen, who can do what you would, I ask of you, that after such a vision, his sentiments preserve their perseverance. May your protection curb his mortal passions. This is the beautiful prayer that Dante Alighieri wrote in his Divine Comedy in Paradise, Canto 33 or 33rd. Do you have questions?
Is the sin of fornication and the ego of lust, are they two separate energies? Because we know that a child doesn't have an ego until like 18 months. But he still inherits the sin of fornication?
Well, the child, the question is that the child has no lust when he's being born. It's true. But that body is the outcome of lust. We have to be very clear and to clarify. Even though the child has no lust yet, that lust is inherited in his bones, blood, and genes, that his parents are placing, you know. Behold here, that's why it is stated that in Judaism, for instance, a Jew is the one that is being born from a Jewish woman. Because all those substances and elements in order to be physically a Jew are within the womb of the Divine Mother. And of course, that inheritance will take care when that body grows up. And that lust that is not yet into that newborn baby will be after the creation of his personality. Because the only element that is free is the essence. That essence is precisely that element, the 3% of consciousness, that is in contact with the Divine Mother. That 3% of essence, that child, can see the Divine Mother, but also see the monsters that he created in past lives that go around the place where he is resting and wants to enter his new body. But because he has no personality, he has just crying. Sometimes he's scared to see those monsters. But when the personality is built, then the monster of lust, the monster of greed, the monster of anger, vanity, pride, and all of that that we have in abundance, enter. And that beautiful baby that was chaste and pure is now another adult that will create, through fornication, another baby. Unfortunately. Yes?
Can you explain the relationship between the universal cosmic mother and the universal cosmic father? Are they both the absolute?
The divine mother is the primordial substance. And the divine father, of course, places his seed germ, or we said seed substance, in order for the universe to emerge. The Divine Mother develops the universe, but he needs that seed from the Father. We will say that the cause of the universe and everything that exists is feminine, more feminine than masculine, because the Father acts according to the law. But of course, we have the duty to honor father and mother, because the universe exists because the imbalance of our psyche, our spirit. But by working with father and mother, and by equilibrating the forces and substances, then the Father is happy, because the Divine Mother then is acting according to his law. Before that, because of ignorance, the Divine Mother creates elements which are in disequilibrium, and that's precisely the karma of the gods, the karma of the worlds, the karma of people. And that's why we had to pray to the Father, to the intersection of the Divine Mother. The prayer of the Lord is precisely one of the prayers that was left by the Master Jesus. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Let us bring the Father into our kingdom, which is this matter that we have. Because everything that is created is from the Divine Mother, whether in the right or the wrong way. But by bringing the Father, we do the right thing. That's why the Holy Spirit fecundates matter in order to appear. In other words, God needs of matter in order to exist. The positive aspect of God needs the feminine aspect in order to exist. Without the Divine Mother, God cannot exist. So God is masculine and feminine. So honor father and mother. Another question?
You said the crystallizations of matter, three of them, you said was mind, intelligence, and ego.
Mm-hmm. No, intellect.
Mind.
The, it says eight, the Divine Mother, the Prakriti, according to the Lord Krishna. Lord Krishna says, my Prakriti is the womb. And she is divided in eight aspects or eight modifications: fire, air, water, earth, the space, mind, intellect, and ego. Mind exists in all the kingdoms. That mental matter that through which the Divine Mother works in the mineral, plant, animal kingdom. But only in the this level in which we are, the intellectual animal level, is where that mind transforms into intellect. and thus a mechanical work of the Divine Mother in nature. The intellect, of course, is the top of evolution. When that intellect develops at the level at which we are right now, then turns into ego. The other aspect. That ego is created in order to be disintegrated, because that is matter. The substance has to return to its own source, the primordial substance. So the ego enters into the abyss and is disintegrated by the forces of the Divine Mother. Problem is that we are bottled up into the ego as consciousness. Yes? The Buddhas what?
The Buddhas deny the mother while the Gnostics marry the mother. Is this true?
No. The Buddhists don't deny the Divine Mother. What they deny is the mechanicity of nature that we have to control. Because, as I said, the mechanicity of nature works in the mind. The mind is mechanical. We're talking about the mechanicity of the mind. And of course, we Gnostics are against that. It brings into my memory precisely the magic flute of Mozart. When this prince is going to make a great task to liberate the consciousness represented by Tamina. And he's Tamino, right? And he's sent by the Divine Mother. The Divine Mother that in the end is turning into his own enemy. Right? His own nature. See right now, behold, our own particular nature, our own particular mother is lunar, is mechanical, bestial. We are the prostitute, which is talking in the Gospels. That prostitute is Mary Magdalene, talking here in symbolic way now. Our own matter is Mary Magdalene, a prostitute. So let this prostitute Mary Magdalene here, represented in our physical body, to repent. Let Jesus take those seven sins out of this prostituted matter, and then Mary Magdalene will be his wife. You see, that's another symbol of that. And then, of course, we will worship the higher aspects of the Divine Mother represented. For instance, Ramakrishna worshiped that higher aspect in his wife as a representation of that. That's why it is written that the man should be or should see his Divine Mother in his wife, and the wife should see his Divine Father in him. So, of course, Buddha was already dead, psychologically speaking, and that's why he denied. That's why you have to, when you read in any religion, condemnations, accusation towards the feminine aspect, which is represented by the woman, you have to understand this. That is your own physical body, your own feminine mechanical aspect that the gospel or the religious is talking against you. It's not against the woman, because the physical body is feminine from a Kabbalistic, alchemistic point of view. That's the prostitute. And of course, when we enter into the second birth, and then we have another nature, which is virgin, which is positive. And that's precisely what the great masters in Buddhism, Taoism, Christianity, Islam work or talk about. This is why we have to understand, in order not to fall into confusions. And of course, Gnostics and Buddhists, the same. Another question? Learn how to read the scriptures, whether from Buddhism, Christianity, Taoism, Islam, because all this beautiful knowledge is written also in the Quran. Muhammad dictated that. It's beautiful. But you have to know how to read. Jesus also, Moses, Krishna, is everywhere. And these two aspects. In Hinduism, it's more clear. The Divine Mother, you see in different aspects. Kali, Durga, Parvati. Many aspects of that feminine aspect that we need to study because they have many aspects. We talk about that in other lectures, about the five aspects of the Divine Mother related with the Divine Cow. The Divine Cow represents the Divine Mother. That matter that had to give us his milk, wisdom. And the womb of that Divine Cow is the spinal medulla. You had to be born there. Do you have another question? Thank you very much. And next Saturday we talk about Libra.
Gnostic Radio is made possible through the financial support of listeners like you. To make a tax-deductible donation, visit our website at GnosticTeachings.org. For questions about this or other lectures, we invite you to participate in the free discussion forum at GnosticTeachings.org. Thank you for your support. May all beings be happy.